they've gotten off to quick starts in the early rounds. And they have not been tested yet. Baylor has had a pretty easy ride here through two rounds. Wisconsin, on the other hand, took a major blow from Oregon in the first half, had to make a big comeback. And we'll see if that factors in here against Wisconsin.
Chloe Jefferson opens the scoring with a nice reverse move. Wisconsin in the white and Baylor in the black.
Jefferson scoring early, Marv, is a good sign. I think that's a big factor in this game. Can he establish the post against Wisconsin as he did in the first two rounds?
Oh, a series of moves beautifully done by the seven-footer Frank Kaminsky.
And that's what you have to do. You can't just settle for three-point looks against this zone. You have to be able to score inside. Kaminsky is just the guy to do it.
Baylor going 26-11 overall. 9-9 of the Big 12. Austin unable to hit him and deflected out of bounds. Wisconsin 28-7, 12-6 in the Big 10. A very streaky season. They start out 16-0, best start in school history. They lose 5 of 6, 5 losses to Big 10 opposition, and then they win 8 in a row against the Big 10. This is Brust. They flip it around. Kaminsky. And back comes Kenny Carey. He tripped up by his own man, gets it inside. Ball is knocked away and on the turnover. Here come the Badgers. Decker. But to control that dribble after it was deflected. Rust spinning it down. They work it around. There's Jackson. Kaminsky. So Frank Kaminsky getting good possession
to be moved by touch, get the ball into the paint. It really forces the zone to respond, and then if you get movement around it, you can get an open look.
Hester looking for his shot. This is a three-point attempt, and it's rebounded by Gashin. Jackson very quickly to the front court. An excellent passing team. And they like to work the ball around, as you can see. Decker from straight away. Sam Decker, sophomore out of Oregon, Wisconsin. Last year, a spark plug off the bench, and now a valuable star.
They're making it look easy against the zone, or they're getting anything they want. They've got multiple players they can put into the heart of the zone again at the foul line. Decker, that time, going to the middle, and he gets a wide open jump shot.
Jefferson could not hit. It's kept alive. This is Austin in contact. Austin again, and now a whistle. Foul is called. It is on Austin.
Here's that play I was talking about. They're going to station Decker at the foul line all game. The Baylor guards are not big. Mark, the front line is enormous, but the guards are not big, so they can put Decker right at the foul line, throw the ball over the top to him, and when he gets it, if the bigs don't come out to him, he's going to have a wide-open 15-footer.
Different story here at the start, in contrast to what we saw against Creighton on Sunday, where that zone was so effective. So effective that they basically kept the ball away from Scott McDermott.
I think the biggest difference, Marv, is Wisconsin can score inside. You know, Doug McDermott was really the only option for Creighton to score in the paint. And they had such a small team, they were overwhelmed by the size.
The traveling violation, should say Doug McDermott. Scott is what some of his close friends refer to him as.
I'd like you to call me Scott tonight. Yes. That's okay. Change it up.
6-2 lead by Wisconsin here in the early moments as Carey walks it up. Reveal had a good shooting performance the other day against Creighton.
Baylor, meanwhile, will go against almost all man-to-man. Carey likes that spot going to his right. Can't that one get that one to go? It's a different look for Baylor as well, having to play against a tight man-to-man defense that will really try to get after Baylor.
Here is Russ looking for a shot. And they close on Russ, not allowing the three. Decker. Decker fires. And it's rebounded by Jefferson.
You know, this is a good passing team, Wisconsin is. And when you play against the zone, you can really get a good rhythm with your passing because the defense is relatively stationary. You can start moving the ball and create a good pace for your team.
J. Jett missing for three. Rebounded by O'Neal. And then hauled out by Jackson.
That'll be a story to watch today, too, as Jackson ends up a three way off. But the rebounding totals, while Baylor has dominated its opponents first two rounds, Wisconsin needs to stay close.
Konecki off the double team and a nice pass from Dossier. 6 points for Konecki and Wisconsin with 8-2 advantage.
Baylor needs to settle down now. They haven't been tested first couple of games. This is a team that needs to find an offensive rhythm of its own.
Called on a reach, and that'll put Cherry at the line. So Frank Konecki doing good work inside. Jackson called on that foul. Konecki, the junior from Lisle, Illinois, a suburb of Chicago, has led the Badgers to the quick start. Well, for the Big East, no teams in the Sweet 16. First time that's occurred since back in 1993. How about the Big Ten? Three teams in the Sweet 16, including Wisconsin.
Of course, the Big East is a totally different Big East than what we've seen since 1993. So that's a little misleading. But Dayton, what a story they are. Of course, we're going to see Archie Miller's brother, Sean, here with Arizona and San Diego State coming up after this one. Two brothers in the Sweet 16 for the first time ever.
That game will be on the CBS. Kenny Cherry and superb free throw shooter, 88% at the line. So that stops an 8-0 run by Wisconsin. Baylor has missed its last six shots.
Well, they're 1-for-7 from the field. And Marv, I think what's most distressing to them is Wisconsin 8 points in the paint already. And this zone is supposed to keep people out of the paint. So if they're scoring in there, Baylor's in trouble, because eventually Wisconsin will knock down some three-pointers to support that attack.
Watson Koenig and Nigel Hayes have come on for the Badgers. It's kept alive by Hayes. And then it's deflected out. Last touch by Cherry of Baylor. Nigel Hayes, Big Ten sixth man of the year, made the all-freshman team. There is Scott Drew, Baylor's head coach. It's Kaminsky again. He has 8 points.
Too easy. I mean, point blank range. Remember all those shots that we saw attempted against this Baylor zone last week were blocked. Those weren't even coming close. But Wisconsin, so adept at attacking the zone, they're getting in rhythm looks.
Austin taking that big stride and able to hit on the runner.
A strange looking shot across his body with his right hand. But well done. He is so skilled for a big man.
7-foot-1 sophomore from Arlington, Isaiah Austin. And that pass just floated away. Thrown cross court by Koenig, a freshman out of La Crosse, Wisconsin.
Here's that move off the wrong foot, going away from the hoop. To see the kind of touch Austin has.
Gary Franklin coming on a moment ago for Baylor. He's from the Los Angeles area. So it's a backcourt of Cherry and Franklin. Cherry with it. Watched by Jackson. Gets a pick from Austin. Austin now played by Decker.
Well, when Heslop goes to the bench, Baylor's offense can come to a grinding halt. Franklin gets into the paint but can't finish. And when they don't have Heslop flying off those screens, they tend to stand around a lot and they're easy to defend.
Seven minutes gone by in this first half. We're in Anaheim, California. Hayes missing on that side jump.
But a wide open look. Once again, Wisconsin patiently finding openings against this zone.
A steal by Gusser. He is considered the team leader. And he has made it back from that torn ACL.
Missed all of last season, generally regarded as Wisconsin's best defender and an excellent three-point shooter as well.
Bob Jackson. drive, got it to Gosser. He is stopped.
The first time where we've seen the length and athleticism in that zone be a factor.
The play there by Rico Gathers, who had just come on, coming off a strong game against Creighton. And the foul is on Baylor. It is on O'Neal. That is his first.
Baylor's going to make some changes here. Heslop, Jefferson back into the ballgame. They look lifeless right now. Marvin, they were so good over the weekend. Wisconsin has kind of taken the game to them early, and Baylor doesn't look as quick to the ball. They're not as energetic in this zone. And it's going to be very interesting to see if they can find some footing here with their defense. You look at the numbers, and offensively, Baylor was spectacular against Creighton. And the zone was so effective that the whole game really was working for them.
And they're the same against Nebraska in that earlier game. Now, UA Deacon, 6'9 junior, has checked in for the first time for Wisconsin. Kaminsky again taking it to the rim, and it's rebounded by Jefferson of Baylor.
Good challenge there. Wisconsin again getting the ball right to the front of the rim, but last couple of plays now, their bigs are protecting the rim better and challenging shots.
Torian Prince, who just came on, getting it to Franklin.
A lot of standing around again.
Franklin, that's a two. He had a foot on the line. Gary Franklin, I mentioned, from the Los Angeles area. In fact, at his suggestion, the entire team went to Roscoe's Chicken and Waffles in Long Beach. He said he ate so much he thought he was in a food coma.
Pre-game.
Well, yeah, we'll see how that works out. As Ben Brust, Wisconsin's all-time leader in three-point shooting, who had a breakout game against Oregon last Saturday, able to knock one down.
Boy, did he hit a big three in that Oregon game. The go-ahead three with about a minute to go. That was a game Oregon dominated in the first half before that furious Wisconsin rally.
Franklin looking to get it down low, but it's off the foot of Trayvon Jackson of Wisconsin. It'll be Baylor ball when we come back.
You mentioned it, Marv. 229 threes for his career now. The all-time leader, Wisconsin basketball, Ben Brust.
Date for you in Memphis, the Dayton Flyers still flying high. Watch Devin Oliver from long range for three. And the Flyers up on Stanford, 42-29. Coming up on 2 minutes to play in the first half. Marvin, Steve, back to you.
All right, thank you, Greg. Well, Arizona head coach Sean Miller watching that game with intense interest. His brother, the head coach of the Flyers of Dayton. Baylor in possession. And the ball.
Hey!
Franklin rejected by Kaminsky. Taken off by Jackson. Here's Jackson looking to go all the way. Chances by. Gets it out to Kaminsky. And they swing it back. Beautiful passing once again, and Decker is able to drill it for three.
This is a great passing team, and when you're scoring inside against a zone and you can pass, now you can get anything you want. And what's going to be interesting is to see if Baylor stays in this zone. Well, they played a lot of man-to-man early in the season, but not much at all of late.
No room for Heslop. He had a 1-for-7 against Nebraska and then bounced back, had a huge game against Creighton, hitting 5 from downtown, 17 points in all. Has not been able to get a look thus far. Franklin trying to flip it underneath, he did, and then Kaminsky with the rejection. Knocked it away from Gathers. This is Brust, over to Trayvon Jackson. Son of former NBA standout, Jim Jackson. And it's a bucket by a young man you know very well, D.A. Dukin, born in Croatia. And the son of
Ivica.
Ivica, that's the name I'm looking for. Ivica, who worked in the Bulls scouting department for many years.
I've known young Duhay for probably 20 years.
Now the Powerade sideline report. Let's go to Craig.
Well, Frank Kaminsky is having a major effect on this game at both ends of the court. He is a unique 7-footer who can not only shoot threes but handle the ball as well. He had a school record 43 points back in November. Was 16 for 19 from the field. Here he is with another block right there. He was 6 for 6 from three-point range. Now, when he was in high school, he did not have his parents' height. He was a 6'3" point guard who grew 7 inches during his junior year. He had severe, literally, growing pains, but he said once he grew into his body, he had the complete all-around game that has made him a threat both inside and also outside. Mark?
He has been showing it here in the early moments for the season, averages just under 14 along with 6 rebounds. Shot clock is down to 5. Dominance for 15 from the floor. 10 points in the paint. Baylor, as you can see, nothing going offensively. They have no fault of their game. Now 3 of 14 from the field. Jefferson not able to hit from downtown. So Wisconsin back in possession. Trayvon Jackson. They swing it. Everyone touches the ball on the possession.
You know, Barb, I think playing against a zone as a player is really pretty easy. I mean, you know, you got to make shots, obviously, but you never feel like you're under any stress. You can move the ball at will, and as long as you're a good passing team and you can force the zone to react and then respond another direction, you can get into a great flow. I think that's what we've seen here early with Wisconsin.
Play by Jackson. O'Neal. Shot clock down to 7. O'Neal gets it down low as Jefferson on the post and gets the roll. Corey Jefferson, the senior from Killeen, Texas.
I think that's the one advantage that Baylor has in this game offensively. They've got to be able to establish Jefferson down on the block just to have a foundation, something to work off of offensively.
Once again, you see all the exchanges. Dukin comes out. Jackson off the head fake. Gosser, who's an excellent three-point shooter, not that time.
Baylor doing a better job covering out, and that's going to be a block on Jackson as Royce O'Neal gets out in transition, gets to the rim.
Jackson, a second foul. And you see the 7-footer, Kaminsky, stopping Isaiah Austin. We'll be back in a moment.
Your HDX tablet from Amazon.
Back now, how Wisconsin has built this 8-point lead by attacking the zone. They've gotten the ball into the middle of the floor. Watch the ball movement now as the defense reacts. The players move. Kaminsky slides. All of a sudden, you swing it back to the weak side. Decker knocks down a 3. Easy basket, easy shot. 8 field goals for Wisconsin, 7 assists. So they're getting pretty much whatever they want.
And you see the roller coaster season the Badgers went through, starting out 16-0, lose 5 of 6, win 8 in a row, made it to the Big Ten semis, lost to Michigan State.
You know, they had that 1-5 stretch, Marv. The flu bug went through most of the team in the beginning of that stretch. That had a lot to do with that bad spell. Bo Ryan won't talk about it. He won't use that as an excuse, but it was absolutely a factor. But they've gotten hot here late, and you can see why. This is just an efficient team. They move the ball well, and everybody can pass and shoot, so they're very difficult to guard.
Here's Bruss open for 3. Too much space for Bruss. That's his second from downtown. Baylor also has had its ups and downs early on. Started with a strong Western run. 15 games. Having their difficulties here as a travel is called
I think Baylor's in big trouble, and not because they're down 10. That's not a big deficit, but just because of the way the game is being played. If Baylor is forced to go out of this zone and go into a man, they haven't played man defense in a few weeks. And they've relied so heavily on this zone. It gives them so much confidence. But Wisconsin is just tearing it apart right now. Baylor looks like a team that is dazed right now.
We talked about it last week. The fact that earlier in the season, again, an open three. This time, Gosser not able to hit it. Earlier in the season, their defense in Carlton Baylor was considered soft. And Leonard has come out his own with three, hit a couple the other day. The feeling was the defense was lacking, but it came out as the season progressed.
They went exclusively to the zone. Early in the season, it was about 50-50, man and zone. But Scott Drew decided to go to the zone, and all of a sudden, they really sort of found their identity. And of course, this is a different beast. Kaminsky scoring with ease inside.
Or he's had his way on the 7'1" Alston. Wisconsin with a 23-11 edge.
And they're not showing any stress at all. Baylor is not extending the press. They're not trapping. They're not forcing any difficult decisions from Wisconsin. So the game is just simple right now.
Kaminsky now 5 of 8 from the field. He has 10 points. Good handling. Gosser. Rust. Hayes. Yes, and the foul.
On Isaiah Austin. So just when you thought it couldn't get any worse for Baylor, it does.
Well, a 4-for-18 shooting. One field goal the last 7.5 minutes, Wisconsin, in the midst of a 15-3 run to take their biggest lead of the game.
Yo, Marv, we often talk about defense fueling offense. I think for Baylor, the opposite needs to be true. Their offense needs to fuel their defense. They're 4-for-18. They have nothing going for them. And as a result, there's no confidence. There's no life in this team. I think they've got to continue to pound Jefferson inside, try to establish something on the block. And if they can score, you know, 3 possessions in a row, now all of a sudden you have some energy, your defense picks it up, you can get back into the ballgame.
He's able to complete the three-point play. Blocking foul is called off the drive by Jefferson. And it's on Kaminsky, that is his first. The winner of this game will go on to play the number one seed in the West. The Wildcats of Arizona will take on the fourth seed, the Aztecs of San Diego State, as you look at the blocking foul on Kaminsky. And this place will be packed for that game as Brady Heslop is finally able to find some space and knocks down a three. It may very well be a raucous crowd for our second game.
No, it will be a crazy atmosphere with San Diego being right down the road and then Los Angeles area as Wisconsin turns it over. The LA area is an enormous alumni base for Arizona. This will be a full house with a lot of red and black in the stands.
Third turnover for Wisconsin. As we mentioned earlier, they average only 8 per game, which is the fewest in Division I. Cherry draws the double. Heslop can find the outside shot, and his shot deflected. The follow is missed by Gathers. Nice move by Gosser, couldn't put it down. And able to hustle it back.
Unbelievable offensive board.
Open shot for Koenig.
And the pace has picked up suddenly. And I like the last couple of possessions for Baylor. They found Heslop on the jumper and some penetration. Almost got a putback from Gathers. They need to continue to attack.
Reveal had it deflected away and lost it. Gosser. Switching hands on the dribble, gets it to Kaminsky.
And this is what they'll do. If there's nothing in transition, they'll be very patient, pull it out, and they'll attack from there.
Oh, the rainbow by Nigel Hayes off the bench to hit a second field goal.
He's one of the dynamics, Marv, when you talk about this being the most talented team Bo Ryan has ever had. I think Decker and Hayes, the athleticism and the scoring ability that those two guys give Bo Ryan, I'm not sure that he's had that kind of firepower at that position in the past.
Just under 2 minutes to go in this first half, and a hacking foul off the drive by Kelly.
This was the last huddle for Baylor. Understandably, some frustration. Guys getting after each other a little bit. And then they're trying to slap hands and get themselves going any which way, but you know, nothing's happening at this point.
That did not appear to be a good-natured slapping of the hand. Kayla got the foul. Cherry, who is a superb free-throw shooter, 88% at the line.
Coming up on AT&T at the half, it's E.J., Smitty, Grant, Seth, and Doug taking you out for a live look at Dayton against Stanford, plus the latest NCAA tournament news, all coming up on AT&T at the half. Cherry knocks down both. Wisconsin with a 27-16 lead. Marv Albert, Steve Kerr, Craig Sager. We are in Anaheim, California. It's the West Regional semifinal.
Baylor has switched Marv into a man-to-man. First time we've seen this the entire NCAA tournament. In fact, we haven't seen it since the regular season from this Baylor team.
And it provided a problem. A turnover once again for Wisconsin.
So the Badgers now will have to adjust. They've gotten awfully comfortable. That was a bad ball. That was actually off of Gather's knee. Rust is upset, as you would expect. But Wisconsin now will quickly adjust with their own man-to-man offense, which they use all year long. Remember, not many teams in the Big Ten play zone, so Wisconsin will be very comfortable going against the man.
First release by Heslop, played by Brust. A minute remaining in this first half. Duke came back in for Decker. Metzke up top. Nasser backing his way with a post move. And it's put down by Hayes. Nigel Hayes, who comes off the bench, averaging 8 points. Shooting better than 50%. 6 points, five rebounds in a hurry for Hayes. And that gets the Wisconsin portion of the crowd going. Seconds remaining in the half. It's been all Badgers. And a holding for as long as they can, about a 6 second differential. It was missed by Jefferson. O'Neal is on it. Final seconds. And that'll do it as Kaminsky hauls it in. Halftime in Anaheim. Wisconsin 29. Baylor 16. Frank Kaminsky leading the way, 5 of 8, 10 points. A season low for points in the first half for Baylor. Let's go to Craig and Wisconsin head coach Bo Ryan.
Well, Coach, this is the first time all year you've played a team that plays predominantly zone defense. What's been the key to carving it apart?
Well, we've touched the soft spots. We've been looking for the middle. We've been looking for the baseline, short corners. Knowing that we have some threats from three, they have to honor that, too. So we've been pretty patient, but I'm not satisfied. We should have scored more points in there against their zone.
Well, maybe you went to a man-to-man. You got them out of the zone, and right now you got a big lead, so maybe you should be satisfied. Thanks a lot. Back to you, Mark.
Yeah, I think he should be satisfied. Bo Ryan, who comes in with 702 wins, three-time Big Ten Coach of the Year. Terrific.
King. Buick Regal. The UPS Store. And by Enterprise Rent-A-Car.
Back in Anaheim, California, halftime lead, Wisconsin 29 and Baylor
16, not what many people thought would be taking place in the first half, particularly after watching Baylor over the first two games. Marv Albert, Steve Kerr, along with Craig Sager, but Frank Kaminsky able to get it going early for the Badgers.
Took it right to Baylor in that zone, got the ball in the paint immediately. Right from the beginning, Wisconsin established its offense, and once they got the paint points, now they had Baylor on a string and they could get anything they wanted. Meanwhile, at the other end, Baylor 5-for-24 shooting. We talked about their dominance in the paint in their first couple of wins. These two guys averaged 15 a game the first two rounds. Look at this. They've combined for 6 on 3-of-8 shooting.
Kaminsky, 10 points in all, 4 block shots. He scored 8 of Wisconsin's first 10 points. Let's go to Craig with Baylor head coach Scott Drew.
Well, Coach, how much of your zone defense will we see in this second half, and what adjustments do you have to make to it?
Well, we got to find Kaminsky. We left him open too much, and you know what? He's a good player, and he scored inside more than we thought he would be able to, and credit him. So we'll adjust to that. We'll play some man. We got to score on the offense, and you're not beating anybody scoring 16 points.
All right, thank you very much. Back to you, Meyer.
All right, Craig, for Scott Drew, his third Sweet 16 trip the past 5 years. The winner between Wisconsin and Baylor will play the winner of San Diego State and Arizona to advance. We touched on a level here for that second game. First half, Baylor shoots just 5-for-24. Wisconsin 13-of-27, including 3 from downtown. And look at points in the paint. And how about assists? They swing the ball consistently. It seems every possession, yeah, every player for the Badgers touches the basketball.
And only 4 turnovers. Wisconsin also winning the rebounding battle. That was something that we thought Baylor would have the edge with. But Wisconsin's bigs, Kaminsky, we mentioned, Nigel Hayes, Decker, they've really done a good job battling this bigger Baylor front line.
Wisconsin in possession. They're in the white, Baylor in the black. And the second half is underway. Rob Jackson, Baylor swinging it, everybody touching. Jackson down low, Decker pops it back out. 3-point attempt missed by Rust. And back come the Bears of Baylor. This is O'Neal fading. Battle for the rebound. Kaminsky was on the floor, could not come up with it. Cherry does. And a pushing foul as Heslip was run off the 3-point line. It's called on Rust. That is his first.
Here's some of the second half numbers for Wisconsin. They had to come back from 12 down against Oregon. Last round, had an easy time of it against American University. And again, good defense by Wisconsin forcing that miss.
And another block for Kaminsky. That's his third.
And Baylor back to the zone. We saw a little man-to-man at the end of that first half, but this is where they're really comfortable. As you mentioned, it's just too easy.
Oh, the reverse. Sam Decker on the drive.
Their passing is so in precision with one another. The rhythm, they're finding the openings. We heard Bo Ryan talk about it. They're trying to get the ball in the middle end of the short corners. That time they got it to both.
Jefferson not able to hit, sliding across the lane. Decker moves it back out. Jackson. Gosser.
Kaminsky. I always loved playing against the zone as a player, Marv, because there was never any physical stress. You never got worn down. You just kind of, it was like solving a puzzle. All you're doing is passing, cutting like Kaminsky does there, draws the foul and puts it home. But it's when you can figure out a zone and solve it, the game seems so incredibly easy. And that's what it looks like for Wisconsin right now.
Foul committed by O'Neal. Kaminsky will head to the line on this play, looking for a conventional 3-point possibility.
This is a totally different look than what we're going to see in our second game. San Diego State and Arizona, both man-to-man teams who will get after you physically to the point where you feel like you're under assault for 40 minutes. But this game has been a walk in the park offensively for Wisconsin. They're just out there having fun.
Biggest lead of the game. O'Neal able to get inside
And then a timeout is taken.
That is a coach's timeout for Scott Drew instead of a TV timeout. Wisconsin with the huge lead back in a moment.
Hashtag prove it, visit the Coke Zero Social Arena in March Madness Live. And there is Miami Heat team president Pat Riley. His Heat losing at Indiana last night in a tough physical game.
Pretty good scouting environment here in Anaheim. A lot of future pros in this game and the next.
2:20 in second half. Art Albert, Steve Kerr, Craig Sager. Wisconsin in possession.
Baylor back to the man-to-man. Scott Drew called that timeout. Just did not feel comfortable with the zone. And of course, Jackson now calmly knocks down the three. Everything going Wisconsin's way.
But Trayvon Jackson, his first field goal. He's a 40% shooter from beyond the three-point line. Austin. Neal. Austin had the ball slapped away, able to recover, and now the spin is able to hit.
That's where they need to score. You've got to pound Jefferson and Austin inside and establish something in this game. The question is, can they do it? This is a very good defensive team for Wisconsin.
And pass play intended for Kaminsky. Broken up.
Watch this pick from Kaminsky. Jackson recognizing the man-to-man, takes advantage with that little pick and roll, or actually just pick and stand, wide open jumper.
See, this is the first ever meeting between Wisconsin and the Baylor. They've never played regular season or tournament.
Baylor probably understands how Creighton felt last week when they just destroyed the Blue Jays.
Shot clock down at two. Rush for three. And it's rebounded by Jackson.
How does that happen? Smallest guy on the Badger roster, at least on the floor right now for Wisconsin. He comes away with the rebound.
So a second consecutive possession for the Badgers. Oh, that was too easy, though. Gosser took the push. He had the uncontested driving layup.
And I think Baylor going to the man-to-man, Marv, is, I understand it for Scott Drew, but it's not something that his team has used much in the last month. And Wisconsin is a terrific offensive team going against the man using that Bo Ryan swing offense.
O'Neal picked up the foul, his third. Gosser 87% at the line, the best in the Big Ten. Coverage of the NCAA Division I Women's Basketball Championship Regional Semis begin Saturday at noon on ESPN. For more information on game times and listings, go to NCAA.com. Josh Gosser, who has started every game this season after missing all of last year with a torn ACL. He was slated to be the starting point guard last season. He makes good decisions, but Trayvon Jackson kind of worked his way into it. There's the lob, and it's put down by Jefferson. So Jackson is the point guard, but with all that ball movement, you see Gosser handling, you see Brust handling, along with Jackson.
That's the beauty of this team. Well, they can all pass and handle, and they work so well together, but Gosser has become kind of their stopper. He had a triple-double early in his career, so he is a very talented player.
Decker off the fake. Decker on the five, he's rejected, and he stepped out. Ended up back in his hands, and he was on the baseline. So Baylor will take over when we come back. Wisconsin up 39-22. Here in the past. Well, you can get the most complete coverage of the team that you love and updates on the tournament's best moments with the Team Stream app from Bleacher Report. Go deeper with Team Stream on your iPad, iPhone, or Android device. And you can do it today. Franklin is back in for Baylor. Jefferson off the spin. And Kaminsky not able to hang on.
Well, the most interesting number that I see statistically right now, Wisconsin 26-16 rebounding edge. Some of that is because Baylor has been so poor from the floor. They've missed 23 shots, so there's going to be a lot of defensive rebounds there for Wisconsin, but Wisconsin has more offensive rebounds than Baylor. And that's the area where we thought Baylor could do some damage, so Wisconsin doing an excellent job counteracting that front line.
Austin nowhere to go on the baseline, hit by Nigel Hayes, who just checked in, and a blocking foul is charged to Trayvon. Out of the son of Jim Jackson, who was the fourth overall pick in the 1992 NBA draft, spent 14 years in the NBA. As it turned out, with 12 teams, this after starring at Ohio State, and his dad now a color analyst for the Big Ten Network.
Jimmy, phenomenal player in the NBA and at Ohio State, of course. There's Jefferson, nice inbounds play from Baylor. But Trayvon has turned into a heck of a player himself. In fact, one of the clutch shooters on this Wisconsin team. Made all the big free throws down the stretch against Oregon last round.
Bronson Keeney back in the game for Wisconsin. This is Brust. Kaminsky. Good box out by O'Neal for the Bears. Trying to get it ahead for Jefferson. Picked off.
Every possession obviously critical for Baylor as they try to climb back into this game. They just cannot afford, especially in transition, a careless turnover like that one.
O'Ryan going with a couple of subs. Wisconsin, one of 10 Division I teams, and one of those subs right there again. Nigel Hayes with 8 points, but Wisconsin, one of 10 Division I teams, have used the same starting lineup in every game, all 36, including here today.
Well, the consistency shows. These guys understand one another. That's a lay-in there for Gary Franklin, but Wisconsin has the continuity you would expect from a group that has played together an awful lot of games now.
Packers up 41-26. Kaminsky setting the screen.
And again, man-to-man for Baylor, which means Wisconsin's going to look to swing the ball side to side, and Hayes trying to take advantage of an isolation.
Kaminsky played by Jefferson, who tried to throw the charge. They said no way.
Just on, get up. Ref didn't even give him a look.
15 points, 5 blocked shots for Kaminsky. The 5 blocks, a career high.
You know, Wisconsin's had a pretty good line of big men who are versatile. Kaminsky might be the best of all of them as Isaiah Austin gets fouled, but you think back to Brian Butch, Greg Steensma, John Luer, who's in the NBA now, Jared Bergman last year. But look at this move here. I mean, that's a 7-footer on a spin move. Jefferson trying to take the charge, but really wasn't quite there anyway. Good no call from the official.
Hand for Frank Kaminsky, who sits down 7 of 10, 15 points, along with the 5 rejections. So the double on Heslop, allowing no room, and then the foul call. Combination of Hayes and Brust. Brady Heslop has not been able to get many looks here today.
Well, he's facing a nasty man-to-man defense from Baylor, or from Wisconsin, excuse me, and the Wisconsin players, that's part of the game plan, is just to chase him off every screen. Brust has been on him most of the game, and he is not giving him a look. You can see Heslop now showing some frustration.
Hayes called on that foul. Here's Franklin trying to work off the screen from Gathers. Jefferson backs in, blows the stuff. Dasher lost it. Ripped by Franklin. This is Heslop on the 2-on-1 for Bell. Oh, beautifully done. And Gathers with the finish.
One of the first live ball turnovers we've seen all game from Wisconsin. We know they're number one in the country in fewest turnovers, just 8 per game. And finally showing a little weakness here against the pressure.
Pass down low. That counts for the foul. D.A. Dukin with the bucket, and he will head to the line. It's his second field goal. Foul on Jefferson, his first.
Looked like Baylor was getting ready to make a little run, Marv, but every time that's happened tonight, Wisconsin has responded. They're back up 17.
In Memphis over on CBS, the Dayton Flyers looking for a spot in the Elite Eight. Devin Scott, big rebound and basket underneath. And right now, the Flyers have a 64-57 lead, about 8 minutes to play in regulation. Marv?
All right, thank you, Greg. He's in at the brackets, and you check out D.A. Dukin at the line. Born in Croatia, moved to the U.S. at a very young age. We touched on it earlier. Grew up literally in the Bulls locker room because his dad was working in the scouting department. I won't ask for any help on the pronunciation of his father's name again. But as you were saying, he found that the D.A. was a very annoying kid.
Is that what I said? I thought I said endearing. You
know, endearing. I'm sorry. Yes, as Austin is able to hit. Isaiah Austin coming off a strong game against Creighton the other day. 7 of 11, 17 points, couple of blocked shots, but not able to get going to this point here.
The first two games that Baylor played, they established the inside easily. Hayes there gets right to the hoop. But in this game, Austin and Jefferson never got going early. Jefferson got the first hoop of the game. I thought that was a great sign. And then that was about it for the first half. Wisconsin has really controlled the paint.
How about Hayes, 5 for 7, 10 points off the bench. Torian Prince, 6'7", sophomore, has come on for Taylor.
Hard to believe Nigel Hayes is a freshman. He looks like he could be a middle linebacker in the NFL, or at least for Wisconsin's football team.
And voted sixth man of the year. Long three attempted by Isaiah Austin. 18-point lead for Wisconsin. 10.5 remaining. Second half. Rust not giving any room.
The beauty of Hayes is that Wisconsin can go to him when nothing else is happening, like this, late in the shot clock, and end up with something good.
Austin got a piece of that shot. Nice pass from Hayes, another nice pass. They whip it around. Thrust for three. Yes! What a terrific sequence for Wisconsin.
Unbelievable ball movement, spacing, sharing. This is a fantastic team.
Third three for Brush, 9 points in all, and a foul. So Baylor will head to the line. Cherry will have two.
Look at the passing. The interior pass, another one. Dukin really is realizing that he's got nothing. Brust with the patience, staring at the shot clock. The pump fake, knowing he has a couple of seconds to work with. There's Brust's brothers in the stands going crazy, as always. They're like their own cheering section, that family.
we were talking about that with Greg yesterday.
He actually came over and apologized to me before the game, because his brother came over and assaulted me before the game with his spirit and his energy.
Wisconsin crowd reacts. Nigel Hayes sitting down. Follow the games anywhere with NCAA March Madness Live. Download the app for your Amazon Kindle, iPhone, iPad, or Android device by visiting ncaa.com/March Madness. Jackson protecting the dribble.
Hayes goes out, so Kaminsky becomes the go-to guy if they get late in the shot clock, but the ball will continue to move.
And it did right there. Jackson not able to take advantage.
A little late on the pass from Decker. He had Jackson for a lay-in, but because the pass was late, it took him out of rhythm.
Austin challenging Kaminsky. So that's 8 points now for Isaiah Austin. Got away from Jackson, but saved. Kaminsky wide open. He can shoot the three, passed on it. Goes to the drive. Oh, yes! On the foul. That old extra twist on that driving shot.
That's a guard move, Marvin. He's 7 feet tall. That's unfair. The ability to shoot the three makes Austin honor the shot fake, and then he's got the ability to put the ball on the floor, draw the contact, and a little spin.
Nice.
Oh, man, that's impressive.
Foul on Cherry. Well, Craig touched on it earlier. Frank Kaminsky grew from 6'3 as a sophomore to 6'10 as a junior in high school, so his game changed. Although he did have guard skills, he could handle the ball. We just saw it right there.
A little bit like Anthony Davis from Kentucky a couple years ago. Also the Pelicans now, but Davis was a 6'3 guard in high school. Those skills really translate when you grow, and it's amazing what it's done for Kaminsky in his game.
8.5 remaining, second half. Nice pass. Had it slapped away in a foul. Torian Prince called on the personal.
You know, Baylor has stuck with this man-to-man in the second half because they were torched the first half with that zone. But you can see that there's not a lot of confidence in it, and Wisconsin just picking it apart. Scott Drew has no answer in this game tonight.
So Decker to the line is 68% free throw shooter. Coming April 10th through the 13th, Masters Live streams exclusive video of Amen Corner 15 and 16 and two featured groups. For more, go to cbssports.com/masters and masters.com. Nigel Hayes will check back in this. Steve Stricker on hand.
Speaking of the Masters, I had a chance to talk to Andy North a couple days ago. Huge Wisconsin fan. I asked for some golf tips, and all he wanted to talk about, there's Andy, all he wanted to talk about was Wisconsin basketball. He's a huge fan.
Run off the three-point line. Austin with a nice move. And a foul. Prince came down with a rebound and was pushed by Decker. For Decker, his first. The Badgers of Wisconsin, 28-7 overall coming into today. There's Decker about to take a seat. 3 of 6, 7 points. Wisconsin 12-6 in the Big Ten. Had their ups and downs. Started out 16-0. See the leading scorers for Wisconsin. Bo Ryan's team had a best start in the history of Wisconsin basketball. Then they lose 5 of 6, went 8 in a row. Austin, strong move this time, going right at Kaminsky.
He's done a good job in the second half of going right into the chest of Kaminsky. The problem is it's too little, too late. Austin now with 5 hoops, but not really impacting the game.
10 points for Austin, 8 of the 10 of the second half. Crossover by Lillard, ejected from behind by Kaminsky. Here comes Jackson, whipping by Cherry.
Oh, this is the best offensive team Bo Ryan has had in years. And you can see why. We've seen a little of everything tonight. The attack of the zone offense, the brilliant ball movement in the man-to-man offense, and some transition hoops coming off their defense as well.
Heslop not able to hit the three. He had that 1 for 7 against Nebraska in the second round, and then came out firing, hit 5 against Creighton. Off the turnover, Prince had it slapped away, and let's see who touched it last. Well, last touch by Prince of Baylor. Coming up on 7 minutes remaining, second half. It has been all Wisconsin.
Leads by 20. Baylor has looked out of sync physically and perhaps emotionally. During games, Scott Drew often looks into the stands for his father, Homer, a legendary coach for 25 years at Valparaiso. They have a unique way of communicating through eye contact. However, Homer is not here tonight. His mother, 91 years old, passed away earlier this week. Although Scott and his dad have communicated by phone, Scott misses his father in the stands tonight while mourning the loss of his grandmother.
All right, Craig. Scott, an assistant coach with his dad at Valpo, and Scott's brother Bryce is now the head coach there. Bryce will forever go down at NCAA tournament annals for that buzzer-beating winning shot for his dad's team at Valparaiso, 1998, beating Ole Miss. And then Bryce played 6 years in the NBA. Just under 7 remaining in this second half.
Here's that swing offense, ball going side to side, and as usual, Hayes ends up with the ball on the baseline. Can't convert that time, though, and he fouls out of frustration. Fouls Austin.
Austin, shake it up. So Hayes
try to bat it away. That's Lisa Green, the mom of Isaiah Austin. We've talked about Isaiah, who is blind in his right eye, wears that prosthetic eye cover and protective glass, an injury that was sustained in the middle school, a torn retina. He had kept that injury a secret, known only to his teammates and close friends until this past January when he decided to talk about it. He didn't want the injury to scare away recruiters a couple of years ago, and now is thinking about possibility of NBA.
Yeah, remarkable story, and you love his approach. As you see, his mom, they've been through an awful lot, but Isaiah's approach of being really open about it, talking about it publicly. Remember, there's a lot of NBA scouts. We saw Pat Riley watching this game, and all of them are wondering about his vision and his eyesight, and I like that he's just put it out there and very, very open about it. There you see Riley. And Austin is an NBA talent, needs to get stronger, needs to continue to build his strength. There's no question about his ability.
So it is what is called a common foul, third on Hayes, and they're in the, it's a 1-1.
Yeah, Hayes swiped at the ball and got Austin in the lower stomach area, I guess we would call it, Marf, or upper leg, somewhere in there.
And they went to the replay just to check whether it should be a
to make sure it
flagrant.
Wasn't, yeah, flagrant or advertent.
Austin, a 69% free throw shooter. He averages three blocks a game, led the Big 12 in that department. And apparently Isaiah is all right. He scored the last 6 points for Baylor, has 12 in all. Once again, Wisconsin carefully setting up. Everyone touches.
Yeah, just 7 turnovers on the night. We talked about it. They average 8. Fewest in the country. Very difficult to pressure them into mistakes.
This is 8 for 3. Just hit beat the shot clock.
He is a talented young freshman. Or the heir apparent at the point guard spot, I think, for the Wisconsin team between Koenig and Hayes. You mentioned Vito Brown, really good freshman class for Wisconsin.
Good move by Jefferson, and we get a whistle. Foul committed by Wisconsin.
Koenig won a couple of state titles in Wisconsin. Gifted player, turned down North Carolina actually, and then it took the scholarship from his home state team. There's Austin's mother, she can't believe it. That's the way it's gone tonight. It was the exact opposite last game against Creighton. It was the everything went right for Baylor in that game, and everything's gone wrong in this one.
Well, the Bears have beat Nebraska by 14, led the Cornhuskers all the way. They held them to 16 points in the first half, 23% shooting, and then the zone did the job against Creighton. 55-55 victory. Doug McDermott held to just 15 points.
This is just such a step up in class, though. You get to the Sweet 16, and this is what you're going to face, elite teams rather than just very good ones. And Baylor finding that out here tonight.
Shot clock down to 3. Here's Decker. Rebound hauled down by Jefferson. Cherry moves it up. Cherry trying to split through, and then finds Jefferson. Corey Jefferson with 10 points.
What a great move from Cherry, just putting so much pressure on the defense, forcing the reaction, and then the trail pass.
That is only the first assist for the point guard, Kenny Cherry. A usual stat line, he has 7 rebounds.
He's their engine, Marv. He's never really gotten going. Nothing has happened for this team, but Cherry's play in recent weeks has been one of the big factors for Baylor's outstanding run.
Cherry 0 for 5 today. Hester just 1 of 5, that 3-point. Here's Decker for 3. Slapped back by Koenig. And another possession for the Badgers.
And a 33-26 advantage on the glass for Wisconsin one of the reasons they're in total control of this game.
There's Brust on the drive, and you rarely see that. But Ben Brust usually has most of his field goals off from downtown. Franklin looking to draw the foul, but he lost it. The ball back to Wisconsin, but first, a timeout.
And the highlights have been few and far between for Baylor. Here's one of them, but Ben Brust comes right back and spins in the layup, and the Badgers running away with it.
A look at our game summary. Baylor at 15 of 47. That's 31% from the field. For Wisconsin at 52, including six from downtown. 17 assists for the Badgers.
And you look at that 1-for-9 number. Baylor led the Big 12 in three-point shooting. 39%. They made about 7 per game. We're going to see a Baylor foul. And against Creighton, they made 11. I think they were 11 for 18 in that game. But this has been totally different. Wisconsin plays a tight man-to-man. They took Heslop out of the game early. And there just haven't been many open looks from three for the Bears.
Foul committed by Gathers of Baylor. So both in the bonus now. Now Baylor scored the first bucket of the night. And they had that lead for 20 seconds, and that was it.
That was it. Total dominance ever since.
Nigel Hayes not able to take advantage of the 1-1. Coming up on 3.5 remaining. Jefferson lowered his shoulder, got the call. It's a block. Basket counts and a foul.
Just simple high screen and roll action. Nice feed from Cherry, and you see Hayes sliding in front. There's that point of emphasis this year in the college game. Benefit of the doubt is going to the offensive player on a lot of these charge block calls, which I like. I think the defensive player needs to absolutely have solid position to give him that call. And Hayes may not agree with me, but I thought it was the right one.
Corey Jefferson, 13 points, and he takes a seat. Ish Wainwright, freshman from Kansas City, making his first appearance of the night. They double up on Decker, who would not give up the basketball, but he was fouled. Unless there is a miraculous turnaround, foul is on Franklin. It will be Wisconsin moving on to the Elite Eight to face the winner on Saturday night, the winner in the second of our doubleheader here between San Diego State and Arizona. Well, Conan doing a week of shows from Dallas. Conan Dallas Week starts Monday at 11:10 Central, only on TBS. Cherry trying to use the pick. Cherry. Oh, look out. Brust run into. And a foul. It'll be a 1-1. Cherry called for the foul.
Brust, the number one free throw shooter in the Big Ten, 90%. So you don't want to foul him late. In fact, this Wisconsin team dramatically improved from a year ago at the foul line. 74% as a team. One of the reasons they generally are able to close close games out late.
Ben Brust goes about 6'1", 195 pounds, but averages nearly 5 rebounds a game, which is the fifth most in the nation among players 6'1", or shorter. He's always around the ball.
He's a strong kid. In fact, all these Wisconsin guards, Marv, they're not tall, but they're really strong. Trayvon Jackson, Gosser, a very physical player. And I think Wisconsin probably more physical and tougher as a team than they're given credit for.
Jefferson flying for that rebound, and he is fouled. It is on Kaminsky. That's 3 on Kaminsky, who has had a terrific game. 8 of 11, 18 points, and a career high 6 block shots.
Completely dominated the game at both ends of the floor right from the start. And it just established everything that Wisconsin needed in the early going.
And now Decker will take a seat. V.A. Dukin comes back. We're looking at Corey Jefferson playing in his final game, a senior out of Killeen, Texas. Baylor's leading scorer, 13 points, 8 rebounds. Led the Big 12 with 11 double-doubles. There's some pressure and a foul reaching is called on Gathers.
Crowd booing. I think it's probably the San Diego State and Arizona fans who are booing. They want the next game to start.
Game two of our doubleheader here on TBS. Number one seed in the West, Wildcats of Arizona, taking on the fourth seed, the Aztecs of San Diego State. Arizona at 1 point, won 21 in a row, led by Nick Johnson, the Pac-12 Player of the Year. Aaron Gordon, Pac-12 Freshman of the Year. What a matchup at point guard. T.J. McConnell of Arizona going against Xavier Thames of San Diego State, who comes off a 30-point performance.
Two of the best defensive teams in the country. Both clubs get after it man-to-man. A lot of athleticism on the floor. And points can be very difficult to come by.
Jefferson for three. Russ with the rebound. It will be a different crowd atmosphere for Arizona and San Diego State. And kind of quiet side here for this first game.
It has been really from the beginning just lifeless in this building, other than the pocket of Wisconsin fans who have enjoyed every second of it.
And the foul is picked up by Austin. So Kaminsky to the line. He's 2 for 2 at the line, a 77% free throw shooter. A long day. Brady Heslip had the big one against Creighton, 5 for 7. And 3-point land, 17 points with the bounce back after the struggles against Nebraska.
In Heslip's defense, I mean, he hasn't had a look in this game. Wisconsin's defense has been so good, and Baylor never found any kind of rhythm offensively that possibly could have generated an open look. There's another contested shot as he misses from three.
And the foul is called by the trail official. It is on Austin, number 4. So we're down to 2:12 remaining. Double bonus situation as Gosser, who is a superb free throw shooter at 87%, is at the line. Well, you can track all of your fitness goals and devices in one place with Upwave. Track it, as they say, Steve, sync up now at upwave.com/track it.
Is that what they say?
They do.
The kids these days, is that what you're referring to?
Exactly.
They, yeah.
Franklin from deep. Not able to hit from downtown. Ball deflected out and last touch by Wisconsin.
Maybe. Bo Ryan doesn't agree. Looked like it might have gone off of Austin's shoulder. Nevertheless, Baylor will retain possession. I wonder if he'll continue to foul here with 2 minutes to go. Down 20. Carey goes to the rim and gets fouled.
Mentioned Bo Ryan, what a job in his 13th season as head coach of Wisconsin. His teams have made it to the NCAA tournament all 13 of his seasons. This is 30th season overall as a head coach. He's had unparalleled success. This will be win number 703, putting him on a very short list. And there is the athletic director at Wisconsin, former head football coach Barry Alvarez.
He's got to be thrilled with the job Bo Ryan has done, as Wisconsin is about to advance to the Elite Eight for the first time since 2005. They went to the Final Four back in 2000 under Tony Bennett. It's a team that has been so consistent, kind of under the radar. They've become one of the elite programs in the country. Wainwright fouls Jackson. And I guess, you know, you want to teach your kids never give up. But This is kind of getting ridiculous.
Wisconsin has one NCAA championship. Steve, you may recall, it was back 1941.
I do remember that game. Stayed up late to watch it.
You had one of the 87 television sets right. that were available at the time.
I was heartbroken. I was cheering for Baylor that night. Yep, there it is. There it is. Right from my TV screen in my living room.
And that is vintage. I mean, green, it's all you want. Just under 2 minutes to play. Cherry splitting through. Battle for the rebound, and Wisconsin in possession. Traveling violation went up and down and nowhere to go.
Foul or turnover from Jackson, who will immediately be sent to the bench. Bo Ryan basically motivates his players by benching them anytime they make a turnover or miss a box out. They automatically go to the bench, and the players respect that. They understand it. They buy into it. You know, some players could lose confidence if they were staring over at the coach every time they made a mistake, but these guys buy into what Bo Ryan is teaching.
Cherry able to hit on the drive as we come up on a minute and a half remaining. Here's Brust. Had no problem with the dribble, putting the move on Austin. Franklin for three. And now the, not only the Wisconsin portion of the crowd, I believe Arizona fans and San Diego yeah. State fans, they want to see their teams out on this floor. They want this to end as we come up on a minute to go.
Finally, it looks like Scott Drew is thrown in the towel. Yeah. Baylor will not foul, but what a performance from Wisconsin. This was dominance from the first minute.
In fact, Bo Ryan looking to empty his bench. Wisconsin will go to 29-7. 12 wins the last 14 games. A look at the Baylor Bears season. Recap, third most wins in school history. They win 12 of their last 15 after the 2-8 start, making their third Sweet 16 appearance the last 5 years. And you see the departing seniors, they get a hug from the head coach. Wisconsin will advance to the Elite Eight for the first, actually the third time since back in 1985. Fifth Elite Eight appearance in school history. And they'll go up against the winner between San Diego State and Arizona. That's coming up in the second of our doubleheader here on TDS as Cherry is able to drain the three. This one is winding down. Jordan Hill, who just came off the bench. That's Hill, number 11. Ball slapped away. Wainwright with the steal, chased by Hill, and a foul. Jordan Hill, a 6'3" freshman out of Pasadena.
It's a tough scene there, a familiar one in this tournament, Marv. The emotion of such an abrupt ending to your season, or in many cases your career, which is the case with Corey Jefferson and Brady Peslip.
Jordan Hill appearing only in his 11th game. You see the three seniors. Isaiah Austin finishes with 12 points. Corey Jefferson with 15. Brady Heslip just one of six from the field. And Cherry is a junior, and this may be the last possession.
Well, for Wisconsin, they move on. It's the magic of this tournament. When you can get on a roll and continue to move on, you get one step away from the Final Four and about 48 hours to prepare for that moment. Pretty special.
Frank Kaminsky leads the way with 19, plus a career-high 6 blocks. Ben Bruss, 14 points, including 3 from downtown, and a lift off the bench from Nigel Hayes, 10 points on 5 for 9 shooting. So Wisconsin on to the Elite Eight. We thank our producer, Scott Cockrell, celebrating a big birthday today. Our director, Lonnie Dale, statistician, Paul Evans. It was Baylor all the way, doing it right from the start. Marv Albert, Steve Kerr, Craig Sager saying so long for now from Anaheim. Coming up next, San Diego State versus Arizona. Continues to CBS for UCLA against Florida. We'll send you to our studios after these words.